Here's kind of a strange little theorem. It's called the GZ theorem. Let G be a group and let Z of G be the center of G. As you read, remind yourself what things mean. That's the set of all things in G that commute with everything else in G. All the elements of G that commute with every other element. It is a normal subgroup. That was an example earlier in chapter 9. Given any group, the center of that group will be a normal subgroup. If you think about that, it makes sense. The commutivity of elements in the center is the reason. So we can form the factor group. The GZ theorem says if the factor group is cyclic, then G is abelian. It's kind of a strange little theorem because think about this a little bit more deeply. It's really saying if this factor group is cyclic, yes, then G is abelian, but what would that mean about the center? If G were abelian, the center would be the entire group, which would mean this factor group is trivial. Z of G would be all of G, so there'd only be one coset. Kind of a strange little fact, but true. The author does emphasize most commonly this is used in the form of its contrapositive. If G is not abelian, then the factor group is not cyclic. This particular factor group of G by its center, which is kind of interesting as well. Like, okay, you can, unless G is abelian, you never get this to be a cyclic group. That actually has implications for what we just talked about with regard to this factor group of D4 by R0, R180, which was the center of D4. This can't be a cyclic group. It's got four elements, these four cosets. It can't be cyclic, so it's not isomorphic to Z4. Notice the identity element, which is the R0, R180 coset, is along the main diagonal. You square any of these cosets, you get the identity coset. It's isomorphic to the external direct product of Z2 and Z2. That's what it's isomorphic to, which is not cyclic. Okay, as one example of this. But let's look at its proof. First of all, first sentence, since G is abelian is equivalent to the center being all of G, it suffices to show that the only element of this factor group is the identity coset. What's their goal? Their goal, they're trying to prove this if-then statement as is. They're trying to prove that if this factor group is cyclic, then G is abelian. They're trying to effectively show this is trivial, just like I mentioned a few minutes ago. It's only got one element. Toward this end, assume that this thing right here is a generator. We are assuming this factor group is cyclic, therefore it's got to have some generator. Some coset has got to generate this entire factor group, meaning the factor group is all powers of this particular coset. Don't misunderstand this notation. Make sure you understand that Z of G is the center of G. It's a subgroup of G, a normal subgroup. Little g is an element of capital G. This is a left coset, and we've got the cyclic group notation around it. We're assuming it generates this factor group. So suppose that's a generator. Let A be an element of G. We know there exists an integer I where this is true. Why? Always ask yourself why. There is effectively an arbitrary coset in this factor group. But the factor group is generated by this coset. So by definition, that means that that arbitrary element of the factor group has got to be a power, that particular coset. But how do you simplify this? You're raising a coset to the ith power by definition of coset multiplication. That means multiply G to the by times itself to the ith power. But what does that mean? Thus, this is true. That's probably the hardest step right there. Thus, A equals G to the I times Z for some Z in ZG. Why? Properties of cosets. If AH equals BH, that's equivalent by properties of cosets. You remember this? To A inverse B being an H? Which is equivalent also to its inverse being an H, which is B inverse A. This would mean, for example, A inverse B equals H for some H, which would mean B equals AH. Let's call it H1. This would mean B inverse A equals H2 for some H2 and H, which would mean A equals BH2. When you know two cosets are the same, you can conclude relationships between those representatives, A and B. That's what the author did here, without really telling you explicitly, assuming you know that property of cosets well enough to realize it. We've got an equality of cosets here. There's an A there. This G to the I is like the B. A is going to equal B times Z for some Z in H. The Z of G is the H. That's like this statement right here. Got the A, the B is the G to the I, the Z is the H2. H, capital H, is the center in this case. That's the key step that might be the most difficult to realize. Got to remember properties of cosets to see that. G to the I and Z both belong to these, what's this? This is the centralizer of G, of little g. Why? Well, G to the I commutes with G for sure. G to the I commutes with G because it's a power of G. You could write that. And Z is in the centralizer of G as well because Z is in the center. It commutes with everything, so it commutes with G. The centralizer of G is a subgroup of capital G. So if you've got the product of two things in that centralizer, the result will also be in the centralizer. A is an arbitrary element of G, and it commutes with little g. So little g must be in the center, and that means this is trivial. It's got to be the only element of that.